and welcome to CivilNet. Following the OSCE Minsk Group co-chairman's visit to Nagorno-Karabakh, also their meetings with Armenian and Azerbaijani authorities, they held a press conference in Yerevan on April 9th. Meanwhile, outside of the Marriott Hotel on Armenia's Republic Square, there was a protest rally with very clear demands, point to point, as to what Armenia's society in large would expect from negotiations or the peace process. And today we're talking with Maine Manoucharyan, one of the organizers of the protest and also the person who read out this demands. Thank you for joining us, Maine. And I would just first of all ask you, why did you feel the need to organize such a rally and put together this list?
Thank you for having me here. Actually, the need was technically connected with the fact that the international community has some attention during this, after this four-day war on Armenia, and we had also journalists on the ground, and the 9th of April was chosen because the OSCE Minsk Group co-chairmen were supposed to come out with statement regarding the negotiation processes that was going on for a couple of days after the four-day war. Generally, the need was there, unfortunately, because during this first week of April, the Armenian society was kind of held was blindsided because we did not have very clear information what is happening behind the doors. And the Armenian authorities actually failed to provide this information. We had no clear understanding who is negotiating, what is at stake, what is on the table. And first of all, we did not also see the clear demand from the Armenian side after this war, the ceasefire took place, what is going to happen with the Nagorno-Karabakh during the negotiation processes, whether they're going to be part of it or not, whether Armenia is actually raising a stronger voice in that regards.
The protest was also titled Against the International Inactivity or the Silence. So, of course, You would have to raise issues with the international community, like representatives in Yerevan, but also from what I understood from the event, that's something that internally the society needs to discuss. So from that perspective, how did you put together the demands, and if you actually expect any response from the international community?
Well, I need to give you a little bit of a backstory, because when we initiated the event on Facebook and social media, we did have a lot of criticism regarding the why the protest is not against the ruling regime in the country, why do we actually don't pay attention at the corruption that took place that actually cost the lives of our soldiers on the border. And also another one was why is not directed against Russia, because it's the main weapon supplier of Azerbaijan. I should, when we try to actually explain people that saying international, that also includes Russia. And judging from the pace of our rally that day, it was actually very clear, because the noise was much bigger in front of the Russian embassy. And I should also mention that with this list of demands, there was $1 bill attached to this letter as a sign of protest, that if you guys need money, then here's a dollar from us. Just stop supplying the other side. And it's not just because, you know, the argument that if not from Russia, they will buy it from somewhere else does not hold any ground, because technically Russia is one of the negotiating sides of this, is one of the mediators of this conflict resolution. So arming one side is clear that one side is going to shoot it one day. So technically that was the biggest part of demands, and it is included in the demands as well.
Yes, also because even the Armenian Prime Minister was said, if not Russia, then would you prefer if Turkey sold arms? But my argument in this case would be, well, maybe not Smerch, you know, which is being used. And this is very clear, and you mentioned it in your demands, that especially Russia, and that you also suggest that there should be sanctions against any. But this is something, do you expect to be at any international level to be heard or considered?
Obviously, we as a society all we can do is to do something. So I think why we came up with this idea, and I should also mention that all the demands were kind of consulted on the platform on Facebook. We were just asking people to share whatever clear suggestions they have, and we as a team try to put together the most pragmatic ones and the ones that are lacking right now on the negotiation table. So we did actually We were not naive to think that the international community or Russians or the minister or the OSCE co-chairs will just take it and implement it. But we actually tried to also put some sort of pressure on the Armenian diplomatic corps and especially on the President Sargsyan to actually pay attention to those things and speak up and technically let us know what they're doing on the ground. I'm sure you all are very well aware that on Facebook there is a search of the foreign affairs minister of the country who is literally absent from the scene. We do not see any official statement. We do not have any press corps on the place that is reporting every hour saying what is going on. So everybody is just literally sharing information, which is not probably accurate, which is full of rumors. So we just try to take some initiative.
But in any case, civil society cannot take the place of a diplomatic, of Armenian diplomatic corps. Can we influence it, though?
Well, we have to make sure that our position is clear. We have to make sure that we are following and that we're not going to forgive any mistakes in this case. I mean, for now, I personally expect the ruling regime today to actually make sure that they use this four-day war as a clear statement, enough is enough. It's time for Nagorno-Karabakh to return back on the negotiation table. It's time for them to say, to actually express their own interest and their position, because Armenia cannot negotiate on behalf of Nagorno-Karabakh. If we de facto accept the fact that it is an independent state, then one day Russia can negotiate on behalf of Armenia. Like, why don't we just actually make it clear that it's Karabakh time to talk? And the excuse of, you know, Robert Kocharyan pulling out Karabakh from the negotiation table, it's not valid anymore. The pressure is on the current government to actually take the initiative and move it forward.
Yeah, the President Serzh Sargsyan also made such a statement with the OSCE ambassadors earlier, like I think it was on during the second day of when the conflict started, and he said if this continues, Armenia will recognize Nagorno-Karabakh. So is that something of a bluff, or do you think that's actually something that the authorities are thinking about?
Well, I think recognizing Karabakh is not the place you should start now. I mean, it's my personal opinion. I believe that it's time to for Armenia to step back and bring in Karabakh to the process. And the fact that Armenia was technically blowing off, all the negotiation processes were going on in the secrecy as such, and Karabakh was kept out of the loop, that kind of gave the carte blanche to Aliyev to attack. That was the weak stand of our diplomatic corps made that happen.
Well, the Siemens Group press briefing was expected at 3 or 4 o'clock, and then it was postponed for about an hour and a half. Do you think it had something to do with the rally going on?
Well, I don't want to speculate on that, but we were in front of the Russian embassy when the correct time happened, and they called us, our people called us and said that it's happening there now. We kind of skipped the U.S. embassy march, and we went to the Marriott Hotel to make sure that the letters are delivered. And we did have a chance to, U.S. Ambassador Mills was there, and he did agree to meet with us. And he did take the letters for the co-chairs, and he promised us to deliver it. I believe he did it. And also, we did express our own concerns. I should also mention that the French embassy sent a gendarme, one of the guards, to pick up the letter. The Russians did not actually send anyone to take it, but that was also probably because they did feel maybe the guilt, I don't know. But we did deliver.
But maybe
all the
they
letters.
Felt more threatened by you than
maybe,
anyone else.
Yeah, maybe. But we were peaceful.
Yes, and some of the demands you represented, the OSCE Minsk Group co-chairman also actually touched upon those issues, and they made it clear that no, we will not consider Turkey's involvement in the OSCE Minsk Group. We are looking forward to working with Turkey. They also said that yes, we are considering deploying peacekeepers, and yes, maybe Nagorno-Karabakh will return to the negotiations table, but not now, maybe when the peace process is underway, maybe then. They also, I think they touched upon a couple of more points, and this was expected, right, for you?
We look forward to working with all members of the Minsk Group, including Turkey.
For me, it was, I mean, what is expected from the Minsk Group co-chairs, it's nothing new, because it's all the same diplomatic language of false parity between two sides, which we actually demanded to end it. Because, I mean, come on, we live in the 21st century. All the equipment and high-tech intelligence and the satellites and everything can definitely prove who started what and what happened on the ground. The question here is, again, whether the Armenian side is ready, whether the Armenian government is ready to put aside all all their allies and all their, you know, the kind of agreements and everything with the with partners who fail them all the time, to put it aside and stand up for our interests. The thing is that the OSCE Minsk group would make such statements, and we as a group made sure that it is clear that we're not buying it.
Yes. So one of your demands clearly says that the Minsk Group co-chairs act according to their mandate and based on their responsibility as co-chairs, request their respective governments to release any and all satellite intelligence imagery from the line of contact, providing clear evidence of who started the thing. And their response was, it is not our mandate to determine who started it. But now my question is that maybe this is something we should demand from Armenia's
Exactly that point, because they must make some demands. I mean, it was clear by the Karabakhi authorities as well, by number of people, even the Russian leaders that were in the country, Medvedev per se, they did make clear that yes, they did have some information, yes, they are aware of what is happening on the ground. So the question is whether our government will stand strong, but rather sending mixed messages, such as the prime minister of the country says, oh, of course, the Russians can sell it, if not Russians, then someone else, then somebody else makes it another softer statement. This is not the time to be soft. This is the time to be harsh, because it's clear that our forces were stopped to go forward and to reestablish the line of contact the way it was before, so that the five positions that we lost in down in Jabrail, that wouldn't be the case. So it's time to say enough is enough. We're not going to stop anymore.
And this is maybe as a question, do you think we do have that political weight to demand more than we're already demanding internationally?
We would have
our diplomacy, let's say.
Unfortunately, we would have it more heavier if we would have a legitimate government and if we would have a less corrupt individuals within army and within the government.
Yes,
and within
the corruption is something that's like floating on the face of the surface after this conflict, because everyone's saying, look at what we're driving, look at the houses we have, how come we cannot afford more weaponry to protect ourselves? And for my last question, what's next? You've initiated something that can turn into something larger, like into a social consciousness. Do you have a next step plan?
Well, I personally don't. I mean, my job as a civil society representative, as a person who is engaged in the political processes in the country, I can do whatever is within my power, which is to raise awareness, make sure people consolidate around the ideas, and make sure people pressure enough the government to actually do something at these days. So that is all we can do. If these signals are not enough, then it might turn into something even bigger. So we have to make sure that this process is, I mean, whatever losses we had on the border, whatever is going to happen, nothing is forgotten, and we should make sure that the government understands the seriousness of the situation, because they really have to get sober on this very fast.
Yes, the government and also the people should understand that what demands could be made and what's the right approach to take. All right, thank you, Maina, very much for...
Thank you for having me.
And thank you to the viewers for joining us.